easy thing for you to do. Your hand is moving right now. You are still showing up at the tomb of every Lazarus. Your voice is calling me out. And right now, I know you're able. And my
Here we are again preparing for our tithes and our offering. And I need to say to you from the bottom of my heart that I certainly appreciate your generosity to the Shiloh Church, for indeed you have been extremely faithful in supporting our church, supporting our tithes with tithes and supporting our offering with generous offerings. And I say to you that we would not be able to do the things that we're able to do to help those within the community, to help those who are in need, to help children get back to school the way they should get back to school if it were not for you. And for those tithes and offering, I say to you that we're extremely grateful. You will find that there are multiple ways in which to give your tithes as well as your offerings. They're on the screen for you. And from the bottom of my heart, I say thank you for all that you have done and shall continue to do for the Shiloh Church. Our Father and our God, we ask now as we come to give our tithes and give our offerings, we ask that you will bless them in a very special way. And it is our prayer, O God, that this tithe as well as this offering will be used for the building of your kingdom. It's in your Son's name that we pray. Amen, amen. And again, thank you for your tithes as well as your offerings.
I know. set me free.
Matthew, the first chapter, we will consider this morning verses 18 through 25. And they read as follows. The scripture says, "Now the birth of Christ was on this wise. When, as his mother Mary was espoused to Joseph, before they came together, she was found with child of the Holy Ghost. Then Joseph, her husband, being a just man and not willing to make her a public example, was minded to put her away privately. But while he thought on these things, behold, the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a dream, saying, Joseph, thou son of David, fear not to take unto thee Mary thy wife, for that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Ghost. Now, don't miss that word, of the Holy Ghost. And she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. Now, all of this was done, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken of the Lord by the prophet, saying, behold, a virgin shall be with child, and shall bring forth a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which being interpreted is God with us. Then Joseph, being raised from sleep, did as the angel of the Lord had bidden him, and took him his wife, and knew her not till she had brought forth their firstborn son, and he called his name Jesus. This morning, I'd like to talk to you from this subject. Lord, what do I do now? Lord, what do I do now? Have you ever found yourself in a predicament where, truth be told, you did not know what to do? Have you ever thought that all was going well and all of a sudden the bottom fell out of your life? I know that some of you have already decided that Pastor is not talking to me because I have had a great relationship. My religion is strong. I've been saved a long time. In fact, I've been in the choir 40 years. I've been on the usher board 20 years. And so things like that just have never happened to me. But I have come to tell you that it does not matter how long you've been worshiping and how long you've been praising, that the bottom can fall out on any of us. Have you ever gotten to the point that the only question that you could ask is, Lord, what do I do now? Lord, how do I handle this situation? What can I do now? Imagine yourself in preparation for your wedding day, and you are not just any old male, but you are a male who is actually a part of a historical family, and you can easily claim that you're in the lineage of kings, and your family has been instrumental in history down through the years, and you have claimed for your bride a young virgin untouched by the hand of man, including your own hands. And you have already registered with the state your intention of being married, and now a long 1-year engagement has begun. And then the news hits. This is when we start hollering, Lord, what do I do now? The news hits that this woman that you have looked forward to marrying with such great joy has definitely shown signs of fertility, and she is with child. However, you know for a fact that this child is not yours. Oh, the anguish that you must be facing. You have listened to her parents plan this elaborate ceremony. Now listen, it would be easier to digest if you knew for a fact that she was an adulteress, because adultery would be automatic grounds for calling the whole matter off. If she had been raped, the law would grant you a visa for this situation as well. After all, according to the Jewish law, you have been a man since you were actually 13 years old. And you've been trained in the law. You've been nurtured in the law. You've been taught to love God with all your soul, with all your strength, and with all of your mind. But your fiance, Mary, has caused you to suffer like you've never suffered before. You aren't the real daddy, but it does not matter that you're not the real daddy. You're not the real father, but people are going to say that you're the father of this child. Is there anybody who understands that sometimes you have to be able to deal with problems, and I'm talking about problems that you yourself did not generate. You did not order from the problem and the pain side of the menu. You did not request tears, and you did not request heartbreaks. You did not ask for the room to be dark on your side of life. Listen, Joseph did not ask for troubles. Let me help you out. Joseph didn't ask for any troubles. Joseph did not ask for any heartaches, no pains. He didn't ask for tears. He didn't ask for worry. He did not ask for doubt. He didn't ask for issues. He didn't ask for drama. And he certainly did not ask for hopelessness. It's not Joseph's fault. Everything that happens in our life does not always stem from something that we have done, but rather from a predicament that we have been put in. Joseph has now spent every waking hour trying to figure out, Lord, what do I do now? That sounds like Joseph, because Matthew tells us that Joseph was a just man. And the Greek word for just simply means that he was a righteous man, and a man who bases his earthly actions on heavenly principles. Check this out. The Bible has all kinds of descriptions for just folks like Joseph. God says that he sends rain on the just as well as the unjust. Jesus says that I have not come to call the righteousness, but I have come to call sinners to repentance. The just shall live by faith. You want to do the right thing. You've been trying to do the right thing ever since you knew what the right thing was. Yes, I can look at you and I can tell you want to do the right thing. But in order to do the right thing, Joseph, look at you. You're spending every waking moment trying to figure out how you can fix this thing. Joseph, can I help you out this morning? Can I help you understand that while you're trying to fix this particular thing, it's getting bigger by the moment? That's how some problems are in life. While you trying to fix the problem, hear me this morning, while you trying to fix the problem is getting bigger. While you trying to fix a problem, it's getting louder and louder and louder. And while you trying to fix the problem, it's becoming deeper and deeper and deeper. And while you're trying to fix the problem, it's getting more and more and more out of hand. I have found out something about Joseph. He was spending every waking hour trying to figure out how to fix the problem, but he has not spent time in prayer to allow, get ready this morning. He spent time trying to fix the problem, but he's not spent, get ready this morning. He has spent time trying to fix the problem, but he's not spent enough time trying to allow the problem solver to fix his problem. Before I jump on Joseph, there are a whole lot of people who have become the handyman of problem solving without the benefit of consecrated prayer. Let me say that again. Before I get on Joseph, there are a lot of us that we have tried to become problem solvers and the handymen of problem solving without the benefit of consecrated prayer. I know I'm old school, and let me tell you, I'm old school, and I'm going to go ahead and admit to you this morning that I'm really proud to be old school, and I'm old school enough to believe that prayer and problems should be brought together at the altar of petition. What you say, Pastor? I said that I'm old school enough to believe that when you got a problem, you connect problems with prayer and you bring it to the altar of petition and you bring it to the altar, and when you leave the altar, leave it there and God will work it out. Is there anybody that can help me to testify that God will work some things out? Come here, David, and see if you can help me. David says that I would have lost my kingdom to Absalom, but the reason I didn't is because I took it to God in prayer. Jonah, come here. Jonah says, I would have been fish food, but prayer made a difference. Listen, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, you remember the three Hebrew boys, said we would have been great house servants in the house, but prayer changed things. Paul and Silas, come here and talk with me. Paul and Silas says we would have been locked away in jail, but we had a little prayer meeting, and when we had prayer meeting, things turned around. Somebody hearing me today, your life would have been a wreck without prayer. You would have lost your mind a long time ago had it not been for prayer. You say, well, Pastor, I'm not one that's praying all the time, and it looks like some things are working out for me. Let me tell you, some things are working out for you, sometimes not because of your prayers, but because of prayers of other people that knew that you didn't know to pray for yourself, and they sent up some timber on your behalf. I remember as a boy, I'd walk in the house and my mother and my father would be praying and they'd say, Lord, have mercy upon our children. And they called their children's name out before the Lord. And my mother would say, there will come a day when I'll be resting in my grave, but watch over my children and watch over my children's children. And my father would say, Lord, bless them down to through generations. Keep your hands on our children. And today, here it is, 2020, and yet these prayers were prayed back in the 90s, and God is answering prayers that our mothers and grandmas prayed for. So just because you didn't pray does not mean that prayer didn't bring you where you are today. I'm so glad that somebody took the time and prayed for me. Is there anybody know that somebody prayed for you? Mother prayed for you. Daddy prayed for you. Grandma prayed for you. And today I glorify God for the prayers of the old saints. You would look at yourself, if you didn't have prayer, you'd be a total wreck. Your problems would be too great for you to handle. You would look at a test and think that was the end of your life. But through prayer, you're learning that it's just the prefix of testimony. It means that when you're going through something, how many of you know God is going to bring you out and God's going to work things out? You would have given up a long time ago had it not been for the power of prayer. Listen, there is a time when all of us have to give way to the leadership of the Holy Spirit and understand that this battle is not ours, that it is the Lord's. And Joseph spent every waking hour trying to figure out, what am I going to do about this scandal? He knew he was an innocent man, but now the scandal was about to label his wife as scandalous, and he knew he was innocent, but he thought sin had actually come in his camp. But the Bible says, listen to what the Bible says. The Bible says that Joseph went to sleep. He went to sleep. How do you know this? Because the word says that the angel of the Lord came to him in a dream. How can you sleep now? out of all the times, why go to sleep now? The rumor mill is about to place your name and your family's name in a whirlwind. You're about to receive a terrible review in the society column. You're about to see what real malice from people is all about. And some of the same people who say that they love you are getting ready to talk about you. Some of the same people that have shared meals with you at your table are about to make you the main course of their communication, and you have gone to sleep. This is actually good news, Joseph, because you were busy trying to fix things that the Lord could not grab your attention, so he took advantage of your predicament. Listen, God will take advantage of your predicament. Sometimes while you down, that's when God has you to look up. He takes advantage of the predicament that you're in. So you went to sleep, Joseph, but when you went to sleep, help me, Lord Jesus, God went to work. When you went to sleep, God started dictating a message to the angel. When you went to sleep, God was giving a passport to the angel. When you went to sleep, but God neither slumbers nor sleep. When you went to sleep, God opened the recesses of your subconscious, and God interrupted the sleeping pattern of yours to deposit something in your soul. And you went to sleep, but God set up an angel and sent him to talk to you. And while you were sleeping, God had your angel to get your attention, and he would not allow you to wake up from your dream until he was finished with you. Maybe that's your story. Maybe God is not allowing you to move from the perch you're on, the position you're in, until God is finished with you. If you're going through right now, understand that you may be going through because God is getting ready to work something better in your life. Maybe God has got you in the holding pattern because he's trying to get you to hold on to his unchanging hand. Maybe God has got you locked into a situation because he wants to show you that he is the door, that he is the way, he is the truth, that he is the life. And maybe God has you knocked down so that he can prove to you that he can lift you up. So you got to hand it to Joseph, and somebody really needs to hear me. Don't let your problems destroy you. Go ahead and go to sleep. Don't let the devil tell you that you're not going to make it. Go ahead and go to sleep, and don't let the devil take your life. Just go to sleep, and don't let the devil tell you to give up, because the devil will tell you to give up. But I tell you, just go to sleep, and don't let the devil's problems rattle you, but go to sleep. But listen, you are saying, Pastor, if I go to sleep, my problems will still be there in the morning. Yes, but may I tell you something that you need to know? You need to know that weeping may endure for a night, but joy is coming in the morning. Joseph, the angel says, you descendant of David, he says, don't be afraid to follow through on your commitment to marry this woman. I know it looks bad, man. I know you want to quit, man. I know that you want to go somewhere else, but what you think looks bad to others is of the Holy Ghost. Don't miss that little word of. It's of the Holy Ghost. And the word of, O-F, denotes that it has been started. It has not been started by Mary, but this thing was started by the Holy Ghost. It didn't start with her doctor's diagnosis. It started with the Holy Ghost. And the Holy Ghost impregnated Mary by overshadowing her, and it was started by him. And if he starts it, can I tell you, he will finish it. Oh, how many times have we looked at our situation and not seen God in the picture? Listen, some of you can testify, you lost your job. But when you lost your job, you thought it was the end of the road. But listen, you found out that God had another job in store for you, and the job he had in store for you was better than the job you had. You've been the tail, but God's getting ready to promote you to the head. You've been in the fields, but God's getting ready to bless you in the city and you've been lied on, but God is preparing you for a better situation. How do I know that God is in this thing? Look at the text and see what it says. The angel, it says, of the Lord came to Joseph, but here's the good news. The angel didn't write the message. Listen, the angel didn't write the message. His job was to deliver the message. Let me say that again. The angel didn't write the message. He was to deliver the message. The message didn't get written on earth, but the message was written in heaven. The message did not become powerful when the angel told it. It was powerful when it fell from the lips of God. Somebody here ought to be glad that God is all off in your business. Everywhere you go, God is getting into your stuff. He's got you on his mind. He's proclaiming freedom from the captives, and he's proclaiming great joy for the depressed, and he's in this thing. And Joseph was given some things from the Lord through an angel that man can't deliver. He was given information during his sleeping hours. He was given confirmation of God's presence. He was given theological information concerning Mary. He was given ultrasound results without an x-ray. He was given a birth certificate without a delivery room. He was given a name to use without stressing over a name. And the name he was given, that name was Jesus. Now, I don't know if you know, but if you read in the Bible, you'll find that name Jesus 975 times in the Bible. Can I just work with you for a few minutes on that name? Because that name Jesus translates as Joshua, the Son of God, the Savior of mankind, that he is God incarnate. He's God incarnate. He's Jehovah of salvation. He heals the sick. He raises the dead. That name Jesus fed 5,000. That name Jesus wipes away all my fears. And that name Jesus gives us hope. And that name Jesus is what brought us out. And that name Jesus never loses its power. And that name Jesus is cooler than the sea. And that name Jesus is more precious than rubies and more precious than diamonds. And the name Jesus suggests that he is God who became man. And the name Jesus suggests that he's man who became a servant. And that name Jesus suggests that he's a servant who became a sacrifice. That name Jesus that it suggests that he's the sacrifice who died on a Roman cross. I know I got to get out of here, but let me finish talking about this name Jesus, and I'm going to take flight. That name Jesus suggests that he died on Friday. That name Jesus rang through the hills on Friday night. That name Jesus rang through the graveyard on Saturday night. And that name Jesus rang through the hell on Sunday morning. Death couldn't hold him. The grave couldn't keep him. Humanity couldn't understand him. Mary couldn't recognize him. Peter couldn't catch him. But early on Sunday morning, he got up with all power in his hands. And I tell you this morning, he's all right. Let me say that again. He's all right. He's the lily of the valley, the rose of Sharon, the bright and morning star. He's Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. He's our all and all. He's a rock in a weary land. He's a shelter in the time of storm. He's a way out of no way. He's the great I am that I am. He's Jesus. He's the Christ. He's the Son of God, the Son of Man. He's wonderful. He's Counselor. He's the Mighty God. He's the Prince of Peace. He's all, and he's that more. And if you don't know him this morning, I'm going to invite you to come and be a part of this fellowship, because there's no fellowship like this fellowship. If you don't know what else to do, then I'm going to ask you to learn to put your hands in the hands of the man from Galilee. The doors of the church stand open this morning. Lord, what shall I do now? Put your hands in the hands of the man from Galilee. We open the doors of the church and we extend to you the invitation. The invitation on this last Sunday, we extend to you the invitation to give your life over to Christ Jesus. And if you've been putting off all year long, you've just put off and put off, now we say to you that now is the time. There's no better time to give your life over to Jesus. How do I do that, preacher man? How do I do that? How do I do that? I want to do it, but I don't know exactly the steps to do. You'll find a number that's on our screen. All you have to do is call that number and make it known, and Pastor Joshua will reach out to you. And I assure you that I'll lead you to this man named Jesus. He's the best friend that I've ever had. I've been trusting him almost 60 years. I met him when I was at least 8 years old. I became acquainted with him 8 or 9 years old. And for the last 60 years, I put my trust in him. And I can testify to you that he has never, ever failed me yet. He said in his word, he says, I'll never leave you, nor will I forsake you. I ask this morning that you give your life over to him. Father God, if there's one in our listening audience who needs you, who needs to be able to depend upon you, I pray in the matchless name of Jesus Christ that this person will surrender, that they'll pick up the phone and they'll call the church and they'll give their life over to you. I just pray in the name of Jesus that you will move in the life of someone else. Don't let it be too late for them. Allow them, oh God, to come under the ark of safety. And we pray this prayer in your son's name. Amen, amen, and amen. Blessings upon you. I'll continue to pray for you this week and ask God's blessings upon you this week and ask God to keep you. I'm going to ask God to touch your life and that you will become better acquainted with him. For again, what a friend we have in Jesus. Lord, what shall I do? Just lean and depend on him and he'll fulfill every one of your needs. Trust him this morning. Trust him. Trust and obey. Amen, amen, and amen. God bless you and God keep you. Let me take this opportunity to wish you a very, very prosperous new year. I pray God's blessings upon you this year, that God will bless you, that God will keep you, that God will order your steps on a daily basis. If you will now bow your heads, I would like to just cover you in prayer as we close out this year and go into our new year. Our Father and our God, we say thank you. Thank you for all that you've done for us this year, how good you've been to us. And as we look forward to this next year, we ask that you would just cover these your people, that you would order their very steps, that their paths would be directed by you. We thank you for being our God and being our Savior, and for the fact that there's nobody like you. You have been a brother, you have been a father, you have been everything that we've needed, and for that we say thank you, God. Keep us now in perfect peace. In your son's name we pray. Amen, amen, and amen. For our benediction, now unto him that's able to keep us from falling and to present us faultless before his throne of grace, to the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and forever. Amen, amen, and amen. Lastly, our acronym this week comes from one of our members, Mona Hartfield, and Mona says, H-U-G, humbleness under grace, humbleness under grace. If you'll lean in, I'll give you that big hug that I love to give you every week. Get ready, get ready. At the count of three, let's go. One, two, three. Tighter, tighter, tighter. tight. I love you from the bottom of my heart. I'm Isaiah Joshua, senior pastor here at the Shiloh Baptist Church in Plano, Texas. I look forward to seeing you next week. Same place, same time. Blessings upon you. May God bless you. May God keep you. That's my prayer for you.
Whom shall I be afraid? The Lord is my light and salvation. Whom shall I fear? Whom shall I be afraid? I will wait on you. I will wait on you. Yes, I will trust in you. Yes, Lord, say, I will trust in you. Y'all help me. The Lord is my light. Everybody sing, the Lord is my light and salvation. Whom shall I fear? You say it. Whom shall I be afraid? No, no. The Lord is my light and salvation. Whom shall I fear? No, no. Whom shall I be afraid? I will wait on you. Raise your voice. Hey, I will wait. I will trust in you. The next part goes like this. Listen, I want you to go home singing this. I will remain confident in this. I will see the goodness of the Lord. Come on, you stand. I will remain.